Hey, Star Wars fans, and welcome to Boring Conversation Anyway. You stumbled across another bonus episode on Star Wars characters. You asked for it, and now you have it. We're going to do Greedo today. But I can't do it alone. I got to do it with my good friend, Thor. How you doing, Thor?
I'm good.
Awesome. You ready to dive into Greedo?
Maybe.
Oh, dude. I'm glad you didn't read this yet, because there's no way that we can tackle Greedo and then not tackle what's happened to him in the movies, right? We have to get into that, because we all know. So that's going to be on this. So sit back, kids. This might be a while. So let's get into the stats. We'll start going. You're going to be so excited, Thor, when I give you a stat, because it's so different than any other stat you've had. You're going to be jumping up and down. So let's get into it. Greedo. He's a Rodian. Male. Hair color, none. Purple eyes. 1.73 meters on the tall side there, huh? Rodia is the homeworld. He's a bounty hunter. Weapons of choice. Blaster pistol. Grenades.
Nice.
Vehicle of choice. Incom Corsair Manica Hunter.
What?
Yeah. Incom Corsair Manica Hunter. That's the name of his ship.
It's a mouthful.
Yes, it is. First appearance, Star Wars A New Hope. All of his appearances, Star Wars A New Hope, Richard Pryor Show, Holiday Special.
Let's You're talking about it. Live action appearances.
Yes, yes. And Clone Wars cartoon.
Right. Because, you're talking
yeah.
canon. Well, you're not talking canon, because I don't think the Richard Pryor thing is canon.
Should be, but it's not. You're right. We're talking about all his appearances, canon-wise, Star Wars A New Hope. Multiple times, they really got their bang for that costume. And Clone Wars. So we'll dive into the old legend stuff, and then we'll go into the new stuff, and then we'll dive into everything that's happened to poor Greedo. Okay. Green-skinned, foul-smelling. Never knew that. That's cool. Bounty hunter whose dreams far exceed his grasp. More enemies than friends. Not very bright. Wanted to be a bounty hunter in the worst way. He's from Rodea in the Tyrus star system. The Rodians considered bounty hunting as an honorable profession and a great sport. Prizes were rewarded to the hunt. Yes, sir.
Well, I was thinking, I didn't want to cut you off in the middle of it, but okay. This is one of the stories that I vaguely do remember from the Tales from Mos Eisley Cantina book.
Oh, sweet.
And I think the story, you can confirm it or not, was kind of like, you know, you assume when you watch A New Hope that he's this like great bounty hunter or something, but it ends up being like his first job, I think. Does that story ring a bell with you at all?
I think it's pretty close.
He is very green when he winds up with Han Solo in that, you know, and ultimately, unfortunately, he's a...
Well, I'll tell killed. You what, I'm going to give you all these stats and then we can kind of grab it from there, because I think you're close to it. I think you might have had a couple jobs before that, but not much. So... let's see. Here we go. Prizes are awarded for the hunter with the most captures or kills. The only dishonorable thing is padding a catch. And padding a catch is driving up the bounty by allowing the criminal to commit more crimes after you've spotted him. So once you've located this guy, instead of you getting him right away and handing him in, you watch him for a while. If he does more, then his value goes up. That's a very dishonorable thing to do for the Rodians. They don't like that. They frown on that.
Mm-hmm.
So the Rodian Council of Justice, frowns on those activities. There, it's a more violent time when he's growing up at his planet, and his father was murdered, and all his riches were seized. So Greedo's mom, Neela, who was pregnant with her second son, and 3-year-old Greedo, and her two brothers all fled at the same time to get off that planet, to get away from this guy who killed their father. Other members of a more peaceful Rodian clan, known as the Tetus, came with them as well. They left in three large ships. When Greedo was 15 years old, he stumbled across the ships in a cave, asked his mother what it was about. She explained the whole thing. A month and a day after she explained everything to him, the person who slaughtered their father tracked them down and was coming to finish off the family. They began mowing down the settlers, and Greedo grabbed his mom, his uncles, and his brother and got out of there. They went to the Corellian system on a moon called Nar Shaddan. Then Greedo up there as an adult, and he was in the bustling district of level 88. He became streetwise, learning petty thievery and black market tactics. Greedo witnessed two bounty hunters, Sprunch and Warhog, killing a rogue Imperial spice inspector. When the hunters were attacked by a cyborg named Gorm, this is great stuff, Greedo managed to save their lives. The bounty hunters cut Greedo in on their job. He decided to help them by tipping off of a cluster of rebels hiding in another part of level 88. When the Imperial rewarded Greedo, he planned to buy a new ship. And that was the Mon Cata Hunter that we talked about that he wants to buy. Couldn't buy anything simple. He was buying the ship from Shug Nix. Shug Nix, Dark Empire, which I recently read because Dark Empire has a lot of stuff that was in The Rise of Skywalker. Mm-hmm. Shug Nix is someone who worked with Han Solo. While inspecting the ship, Greedo was caught stealing a pair of Deke 6 power couplings. Who caught him, by the way? Chewbacca. Chewbacca.
Oh.
So the Deeks were for the Millennial Falcon. And once he was caught, Han took Greedo's Rancor skin jacket as restitution.
Interesting.
Greedo threatened him. Greedo became one of Warhawk's apprentices. And during the raid on the rebels in level 88, Greedo barely escaped. There was a huge explosion. And Greedo's entire family was killed, which he blamed himself because he was the one who leaked the information to the Imperials. From there, Greedo and Warhog went to Tatooine. Greedo hooked up with Jabba the Hutt. Jabba was found of Rodian hunters. They were ruthless, they worked for cheap, and if they failed, they made great Rancor snacks. Jabba awarded Greedo the exclusive bounty hunter contract to Han Solo's head. We know what happened at the cantina, and Han Solo shot Greedo. We'll get into that in a minute. After Han left the cantina, War, the bartender, took Greedo's body below the cantina, where he and his new droid, C2R4, used the Rodian's flesh and blood in their still, resulting in a liquor that was the most powerful for normal drink War ever made. If War could have withstood the intense flavor, he would have hoisted a second drink to salute Greedo, the greatest tasting Rodian bounty hunter of all time.
Wow.
All right. Now we'll get into what's canon right now. He grew up on Tatooine, so they got rid of all that backstory about him going from planet to planet. He's known for his temper. Picked fights with others, including Anakin Skywalker. He just had to know Anakin, right? Because Star Wars is a small world. It's just a neighborhood, right? He just had to.
Mm-hmm.
Bounty hunter who worked for Jabba the Hutt. During the Clone Wars, he kidnapped Baron Papadona's daughters, and he was killed by Han Solo. So like I said, we really can't dive into knowing about Greedo until we dive into the whole thing about who shot first, right? So let's get a take on this. In the original 77 Star Wars, Han Solo shoots Greedo through the table. No ifs, ands, or buts. Greedo never even takes a shot, correct? Mm-hmm. And that was to save his skin because he knew Greedo was going to kill him out of that situation. He knew what was going on. In 97, Greedo shoots first, missing Han, who is 4 to 6 feet away, and hitting the wall. Then Han kills Greedo. In the DVD release, they shoot at the same time, and it's unclear who shoots first. If you slow it down, Greedo shoots first by a millisecond. And then there's that new Han Solo weird head slide, so
yeah.
It's like he moves. Yes. So he moves his head out of the way of the blaster. In 2011, they shoot at the exact same time, and in 2019, we get McClunky for the 4K version.
Yes,
which is again George Lucas touching it one last time, and Matt Wood, who does the sound at Skywalker Ranch, said that McClunky was one of the only words that the actor didn't use earlier because George just asked for him to put another word in there. And he's like, put this in. He goes, but it's the same word. We're going to use the same word twice and have it mean two different things. We can't do that. So we had to come up with something else. And they had McClunky, which is translated to mean this will be the end of you.
Right. So it's some sort of threat to once again justify that Han Solo didn't kill Greedo in a cold blood, that he had a choice. It's the most famous alteration to Star Wars of all time, and something people still talk about.
It's insane, and we're going to get even deeper into this, because George had a problem with this. He had a big problem with this. So 2004, an interview with George Lucas, this is where we get it. He talks about it. It's like this movie, or sorry, it's like this is a movie I want it to be, and I'm sorry you saw half a completed film and fell in love with it, Lucas said. But I want it to be the way I want it to be. I'm the one who has to take the responsibility for it. I'm the one who has to have everybody throw rocks at me all the time. So at least if they're going to throw rocks at me, they're going to throw the rocks at something I love rather than something I think was not very good, or at least something I think was not finished. So that's why he says he did the special editions. Now, paying attention to the fans about their reactions, he bluntly said he doesn't really pay attention to it. Now, in the 2012 Hollywood Reporter, this is where we're going to talk about this, is the controversy over who shot first, Greedo or Han Solo, and we're going to get to what he says about that. What I did was try to clean up confusion, but obviously it upset people, because they wanted Solo to be a cold-blooded killer, but he actually isn't. And I had been done it had been done in all close-ups, and it was confusing about who and what to whom. I put a little wider shot in there and made it clear that Greedo was the one who shot first, but everyone wanted to think Han shot first because they wanted him to think he actually just gunned down Greedo. Now,
I mean, it's not. I don't think it's a matter of wanting to think that. I think that was what was presented to all of us.
See, my problem with this is twofold. One is there's a difference between walking into a store and shooting somebody in cold blood that wasn't going to attack you. We can read in between the lines. We know what the situation was. There's a great chance he's not getting out of there. So if there's a chance you're not getting out of there, you're going to act. Now I want to bring this other part. I mentioned this yesterday. I said there's a connection to this in Empire Strikes Back. There's a scene that Han shoots first clearly, and George never fixed it or complained about it. But when the crazy dinner scene in Cloud City, when the doors open and there's Darth Vader is not swinging a lightsaber. Darth Vader doesn't have a pistol. Han shoots him 5 times.
I mean, yeah, but I think you could, like, I mean, come on. It's a different situation. Darth Vader is known to have killed people, and
you have a bounty hunter. A bounty hunter who's told you that he's not giving the money, he's not giving the money to Jabba. He's done with this. Give me the money, and maybe you live, which you know he's not, because he's going to take the money, kill Han, and then get the bounty from Jabba and get twice the riches, right?
Right.
I never once thought Han was a cold-blooded killer from shooting Greedo first.
I mean, it definitely portrays him as, like, a little bit more of a... I don't know what the word is for it. In a certain light, it does, because you wouldn't think of Luke doing something like that.
Would you like to know what Han Solo thought about the situation?
He probably didn't care.
In 2014, Harrison Ford was asked who shot first. His response was, "I don't know, and I don't care."
Yeah, I think I knew that. It's just, you know, I get it. Like, I get, as far as Lucas goes, like, you know, him always feeling like he didn't get to make the movie 100% the way he wanted to. But there's a difference. You know, when you go back and you change the sound Obi-Wan makes to scare off the sand people.
3 times.
That's not... What's that?
3 times.
But yeah, it's irksome because, like, you and I are used to the specific sound, right, and all of a sudden it's different. But it's not a character-defining moment, yes, in the way that him shooting Greedo first is. So that's the problem with it. It's not just some sort of, like, you know, cosmetic thing. It's not like, you know, adding more X-Wings into the Battle of Yavin or whatever. It's this sort of character defining moment, especially because at that point we really don't know Han that well.
Right. I would say out of all the things, of all the changes for the three movies, Empire is touched the least. Even all the touches to the three movies, they still leave a mistake in with Empire, because when Luke cuts the arm off of the Wampa after he's running out of the cave, they make the noise that the lightsaber is going away. And he's still running around with the lightsaber out, you know, like, you know, the blade out in the air.
Yeah, so it's even called an echo. He was in a cave. That's the echo of the lightsaber being ignited.
No, it's way after that. Good try, though. My point is, you're doing all these changes. Maybe you fix something that's actually a legit thing, right? I say the big three things that bother me a little bit in these movies is the Han, the rework of the song in Return of the Jedi. I like the original song better. But now it's kind of like an MTV video that's really polished and they're like at a nightclub. And I also like the puppet.
Guilty pleasure of mine. I think yeah. I like
it's the okay. One. I like the puppet better than the special edition of the singer.
Mm-hmm.
So I like that better. Now the other thing that bothers me is in the battle of Death Star and A New Hope, there's music cues that don't line up anymore because they put extended scenes in. And you know, you don't want to mess with John Williams' music. So that's it. You know, so I would say clearly, I guess the worst thing to me is this whole shooting thing, because it's just like, what? Why? Why'd you need to do it? I mean, why'd you have to mess with it that much? Listen, it's your thing. It's George's thing. He wants to do it. I'm not going to tell him he can't do it. It's yours. You're the artist. I understand that. But I can disagree with you. And the fact, if you want to change it, I can disagree with you for the reason you changed it. And I don't think it portrayed Han as a cold blood killer. It didn't. It portrayed him as someone who was going to get out of there with his life, because he knew it was coming. Portrayed him as smart. So I don't see the cold-blooded killer at all.
I mean, yeah, like, obviously, like, it's a threat, because he's got a gun to him, and he's either going to be taken in, or he's going to be killed on the spot there. So it was always, like, in defense. I mean, it's the whole question of, like, a preemptive strike being justified or not. But, you know, but it's another part of the thing that, like, adds to his character, and then that makes his sort of arc all the more better when he, you know, you can make an argument, I don't know, that he values life more, whatever the case may be, when he goes and saves his friends. Whereas at this point, it's, you know, this is the thing that defines him as, like, I look out for Han Solo and that's it. You know, it's me and Chewie and that's it. And I'll gun down anybody that, you know, right, tries to screw with that. But yeah, I don't know. But I just watched the original one while we were talking, and it's clear as day. You know, the shot's not that good. It's a big explosion shot, and then Greedo falls over on the table.
Right, just slips.
Like, I don't even think you see a laser come out of his gun necessarily.
It's like, yes, I bet you have.
Yeah.
Right on the ground. That's it. Now so, we get McClunky.
Yeah, that was weird.
Yeah.
I remember you told me to watch that, and I did, and it was like,
day,
I noticed it right away.
Day one of Disney Plus, bro. This is how, and yeah, I can't take credit for it. It is, I'm sitting there, I'm at work. I go hide in work because I wasn't waiting for my break, and I'm watching the episode one of The Mandalorian. And I'm like, what the heck is going, this is amazing, right? And then I put it down. I was like, well, I love it. I love the show. It was, you know, everything we said, it was a lot less than we thought it was going to be. It would be an hour, but whatever. It was still good stuff. And then I see a thing on Facebook. I'm sorry, guys. Does anybody aware of this thing in A New Hope? I'm sure he messed with it one more time. I'm like, what are you talking about? What else could he have done? And then you hear it on your headphones, McClunky, and you're like, whoa, you just do a double take, man. You're like, what is that?
Yeah, any Star Wars fan notices it, you know. And watching the George Lucas, he really didn't have to touch anything. If you watch it, like I said, no laser comes out of Solo's gun.
Right.
You could have made an argument that, like, Greedo's blaster jammed up and his blaster exploded on the spot, because it almost looks that way. If you tell yourself that,
oh, wow,
it almost looks like his blaster just exploded for some reason.
Which makes him lucky.
Which makes Han lucky.
Yes.
But, yeah. But there you go. Greedo doesn't shoot. Nobody shoots first. Greedo shoots first because he triggers the blaster blowing up. So I guess it's the right same.
Well, it's like the same thing in the conversation. It's always about who shot first. Technically, if you're the old way, no one shot first. Han was the only one who shot.
Yeah, there's no shooting first. Yeah. I don't know.
It's such a classic Western, too. He shoots him and then flips him the coin and says, sorry about the mess. It's just, come on, man.
I mean, awesome. I don't know. Like, it doesn't hurt his character. Like, we see Cassian just straight murder a guy.
Yeah, I know.
Like, you know what I mean? And, like,
because he had a bad arm.
You know, we don't love Cassian as much as we love Han, but he's still kind of our hero through that. Yeah. Journey, and you sympathize. You might not think you would make that choice, but you can almost sympathize. You know, he had to do what he had to do.
Oh yeah, man. So, did they make action figures for Greedo? You know the answer
to this.
Yeah,
I had one of them.
They have a lot, and these are not even naming all of them. I just named them when they changed the mold a bit. 78, obviously, Wave 2. 96, when Power of the Force came out again. 99, 2003. 2004, 2006, and then in 2013 they made the 6-inch black series.
Okay.
So yeah, Greedo's got his fill. And it, yeah,
the Greedo figure, I had it, but there was a time where I was just a little bit older. Like, my action figure playing days were kind of behind me. Like, maybe I was 11 or 12.
Okay.
And I found in my mom's closet Lando, Greedo, and I don't remember what the third one was. And it was just figures that she had forgotten to give me many years ago, like she had bought for Christmas. And I was like, I could have been playing with because I only had one Lando figure and it was him disguised. I was like, I could have been playing with the real Lando figure, you know, and right. a Greedo. And I still have them. They're still in their boxes now because I never opened them.
Oh, wow. I just sent you the picture. Is that the Greedo you had?
It's the Power of the Force one.
Yeah.
Which would have been all, those are pretty much all my figures as a kid.
You know, if you wanted to, you could buy a bunch of Greedos, could put them in the background of that Jabba scene in A New Hope, because there was a bunch of Rodians that were dressed exactly like him, which I think it was just the costume being reused or multiple costumes they had for that scene. So they reused
Bounty Hunter uniform.
Yeah, it's weird, right? It was, they were exactly dressed alike. That is a weird scene, though. That, I mean, Boba Fett stops and looks into the camera. Do you ever notice that?
Yeah, you can tell he's winking behind the helmet. It is weird. Like, I always think of it, like, him stepping on Jabba's tail bothers me. Like, I get that they couldn't figure out a way around it, but, like, there's no way you step on Jabba the Hutt and live to tell about it. There's no way. But that scene is always just like a, you know, it's like a cool, like, there's an extra Han Solo scene. Like, that's cool. But it doesn't quite work.
Dude, when it first came out, the step over the tail was awful. It was like they lifted Solo over and then stepped on and then down again.
Nothing about it does it look like he's stepping up. He just kind of floats in the sky and over. I was like, couldn't you have just cut to something? But then you just have to explain how he got to the other side of Jabba the Hutt. But
right, exactly. You have anything you want to add about Greedo?
No.
I think that's it. So there we are. We tackled Greedo, gave you all the information from canon and non-canon. Do you like the fact that he had to have a fight with Anakin? Like, they had to know each other?
Everybody knows everybody in Star Wars. Yeah. What are you going to do?
What are you going to do is right. So I think we're going to take a pause for the Star Wars characters, and we're going to jump into Empire Strikes Back and dive on some guys in there, see what we learned. All right?
All right.
All right, buddy. Say goodbye to everybody.
Goodbye.
All right, guys. Thanks for joining us for another character bonus episode. We'll see you soon. And go make some noise.